In this next set of videos, I'm going to talk about ERP components, what they are, where they come from, and what they mean. In this first video in the series, I'm going to provide a brief overview of what we mean by the term ERP component and how the components are related to the peaks we see in the waveforms. The terms peak and component are sometimes used synonymously, but they really refer to different things. Peaks are things that we can observe in our scalp recordings, whereas components occur in the brain and can't be directly observed from scalp electrodes. The observed peaks are the result of the underlying brain components, but the relationship can be complex. So be careful. Peaks and components are not the same thing. And one of the most challenging things about ERP research is to go beyond the observed peaks and understand what's happening with the underlying components. Let's start by talking about how ERPs are generated. This will be a simplified description. I cover ERP generation in more detail in another set of videos. With a few rare exceptions, ERPs are generated by cortical pyramidal cells during neurotransmission. To be visible on the scalp, a large number of neurons must be active at the same time. Typically, this would be a cluster of neurons in some functionally defined area of the cortex. The extracellular electric fields produced during neurotransmission sum across the neurons in an area, forming what we call an equivalent current dipole that points perpendicular to the active cortical surface. This will give us a negativity in our scalp EEG electrodes on one side of the dipole and a positivity on the other side. If you'd like more details, here are a couple of excellent review papers. An ERP component is essentially the extracellular voltage produced by a cluster of functionally related neurons in the brain. The sequence of positive and negative peaks that we see at a given scalp electrode reflects the sum of many of these components, each of which has its own time course. The components overlap in time, and it's hard to tell when a single component actually begins and ends by looking at the combined contribution of multiple components that we record from our scalp electrodes. For example, imagine that we have the three components labeled here as C1, C2, and C3. Each internal component is represented by an arrow, showing the location and direction of the dipole for that component. And each component also has what we call a source waveform, which is the change in voltage over time in response to a given event at the source. And imagine that we have the three electrodes shown here, labeled E1, E2, and E3. To understand how the underlying components combine together in those scalp electrodes, you need to know a key fact about ERPs. Voltages simply sum together in a conductor. As a result, the voltage recorded at each electrode will be a weighted sum of the underlying source waveforms. There's a different weighting between each component and a given electrode, reflecting the location and orientation of the dipole, the location of the electrode, and the conductivity of the brain, meninges, skull, and scalp. For example, there's one weight between component 1 and electrode 1, and another weight between component 2 and electrode 1, and a third weight between component 3 and electrode 1. You have a different weight for each combination of component and electrode site. The contribution of a given source to a given electrode site at a given time is simply the amplitude of the source waveform at that time multiplied by the weight between that component and the electrode site. Some of the weights may be negative, which just means that the electrode is on the opposite side of the dipole. In this example, there's a negative weight from component 2 to electrode 3, so even though the source waveform is negative going, you see a positive going deflection at that time in the scalp voltage. Any given electrode picks up a large number of different components. In this example, all three components contribute significantly to the voltage at all three electrodes. Here's another example. You can see that we have three components and three peaks. But notice that the first component peaks at 100 milliseconds, whereas the first peak in the scalp waveform is at 50 milliseconds. And it looks like the second peak goes from about 90 to 180 milliseconds, but the underlying component actually goes from about 50 to 225 milliseconds. And there are usually way more components than there are obvious peaks. For example, there are at least 10 distinct components active between 50 and 150 milliseconds in the sensory response to a visual stimulus. And there are clearly several different N2 components that come from different brain areas and reflect fundamentally different neural computations. So peaks and components are not the same thing. We see the peaks, but we can only draw indirect inferences about the underlying components. If you'd like to know more about how ERP components are defined and how they can be estimated from the observed scalp waveforms, take a look at this chapter that Emily and I wrote for the Oxford Handbook of ERP Components.